Although we tend to think of globalization as a modern phenomenon, the hallmarks of its activity, from free trade zones to duty rates, have been around for millennia. Evidence of customs activity has been excavated all over the world, from the ports of ancient Greece to the Great Wall of China.
The evidence suggests that complex systems of controls and taxes on traded commodities were in existence well before industrialization, as well as the reasoning behind them. It was easy to see among small populations that unmitigated dependence on foreign merchandise would endeavor and stress the community.
Scholars believe that the earliest customs fees were actually voluntary and offered by traveling merchants as a bribe to sovereigns for considerate treatment. Over time, this bribe became mandatory. It was called duty, a fee charged for the privilege of trading in a particular kingdom. The collection itself was outsourced to tax farmers, who would use any means necessary, including violence, to obtain what had become an essential revenue source for monarchies.
The first written customs tariff was developed in Palmyra and was engraved in stone. Despite its age, the ancient tariff bears a striking resemblance to the modern harmonized system and included specific duty rates for commodities such as camels, slaves, fleece, and aromatic oils.
A newer concept of customs as a complex, evolving filter began at the dawn of the industrial age when nations promoted exporting as a powerful tool for national wealth. As trade increased, so did competition, and streams of legislation became a necessity to balance the needs of domestic labor with market forces.
Countervailing duty was charged against subsidized products, and anti-dumping duty against unsold surplus. Unbridled attempts to push exports led to a series of trade wars that halted shipping and resulted in economic crashes, revealing the dangers of protectionism.
Following the wars, international organizations were established, and an era of transparent cooperation continues to this day. Despite major advances, the essence of customs has neither disappeared nor changed.
While today's agencies screen for a variety of novel threats, from security to the environment, protecting the local market is the motivation behind every decision, even if it is not always clear to the importer.
The World Customs Organization, established in 1952 as the Customs Cooperation Council, is an independent intergovernmental body whose mission is to enhance the effectiveness and efficiency of customs administrations.
Today, the WCO represents 183 customs administrations across the globe that collectively process approximately 98% of world trade. As the global center of customs expertise, the WCO is the only international organization with competence in customs matters and can rightly call itself the voice of the international customs community.
Customs administrations around the world play a key role in trade facilitation, revenue collection, community protection, and national security. As such, the lack of integrity in customs can distort trade and investment opportunities, undermine public trust in government administration, and ultimately jeopardize the well-being of all citizens.
Integrity is a prerequisite for the proper functioning of a customs administration.
Integrity in customs was initially placed on the WCO agenda in the late 1980s to address the problem of corruption in public service, and more specifically in customs.
It culminated in 1993 with the adoption of the WCO Arusha Declaration concerning integrity in customs, showing the willingness of the international customs community to comply with rules governing integrity in order to reduce and eventually eliminate opportunities for corruption.
In 2003, WCO members unanimously endorsed the revised Arusha Declaration, a focal instrument to prevent corruption and increase the level of integrity in customs. The WCO revised Arusha Declaration provides customs administrations with a practical approach for anti-corruption policies and practices as stipulated in the United Nations Convention Against Corruption, Article 5.
The declaration also aligns with UNCSC Article 7, 8, 10, and encompasses elements of a number of other articles of the convention relating to transparency and engagement with the private sector.
Other integrity development instruments allowing self-assessment, action planning, implementation, and evaluation have been created over the years, such as the Integrity
Development Guide, which was conceived as a comprehensive integrity instrument set In response to the recommendation made at the Third Global Forum on Fighting Corruption and Safeguarding Integrity in June 2005, the WCO produced the first version of the WCO Compendium of Integrity Best Practices in collaboration with its member administrations. It was later enhanced with the WCO Compilation of Integrity Practices.
The WCO recently published a compilation of integrity practices on internal control and relationship with external controls, focused on the four key areas of governance of internal controls, operational aspects, relationship with external controls, and sharing good practices amongst WCO members.
Although we tend to think of globalization as a modern phenomenon, the hallmarks of its activity, from free trade zones to duty rates, have been around for millennia. Evidence of customs activity has been excavated all over the world, from the ports of ancient Greece to the Great Wall of China.
The evidence suggests that complex systems of controls and taxes on traded commodities were in existence well before industrialization, as well as the reasoning behind them. It was easy to see among small populations that unmitigated dependence on foreign merchandise would indebt and stress the community.
Scholars believe that the earliest customs fees were actually voluntary and offered by traveling merchants as a bribe to sovereigns for considerate treatment. Over time, this bribe became mandatory. It was called duty, a fee charged for the privilege of trading in a particular kingdom. The collection itself was outsourced to tax farmers, who would use any means necessary, including violence, to obtain what had become an essential revenue source for monarchies.
The first written customs tariff was developed in Palmyra and was engraved in stone. Despite its age, the ancient tariff bears a striking resemblance to the modern harmonized system and included specific duty rates for commodities such as camels, slaves, fleece, and aromatic oils.
A newer concept of customs as a complex, evolving filter began at the dawn of the industrial age when nations promoted exporting as a powerful tool for national wealth. As trade increased, so did competition, and streams of legislation became a necessity to balance the needs of domestic labor with market forces.
Countervailing duty was charged against subsidized products, and anti-dumping duty against unsold surplus. Unbridled attempts to push exports led to a series of trade wars that halted shipping and resulted in economic crashes, revealing the dangers of protectionism.
Following the wars, international organizations were established, and an era of transparent cooperation continues to this day. Despite major advances, the essence of customs has neither disappeared nor changed.
While today's agencies screen for a variety of novel threats, from security to the environment, protecting the local market is the motivation behind every decision, even if it is not always clear to the importer.
The World Customs Organization, established in 1952 as the Customs Cooperation Council, is an independent intergovernmental body whose mission is to enhance the effectiveness and efficiency of customs administrations.
Today, the WCO represents 183 customs administrations across the globe that collectively process approximately 98% of world trade. As the global center of customs expertise, the WCO is the only international organization with competence in customs matters and can rightly call itself the voice of the international customs community.
Customs administrations around the world play a key role in trade facilitation, revenue collection, community protection, and national security. As such, the lack of integrity in customs can distort trade and investment opportunities, undermine public trust in government administration, and ultimately jeopardize the well-being of all citizens.
Integrity is a prerequisite for the proper functioning of a customs administration.
Integrity in customs was initially placed on the WCO agenda in the late 1980s to address the problem of corruption in public service, and more specifically in customs.
It culminated in 1993 with the adoption of the WCO Arusha Declaration Concerning Integrity in Customs, showing the willingness of the international customs community to comply with rules governing integrity in order to reduce and, eventually, eliminate opportunities for corruption.
In 2003, WCO members unanimously endorsed the revised Arusha Declaration, a focal instrument to prevent corruption and increase the level of integrity in customs. The WCO revised Arusha Declaration provides customs administrations with a practical approach for anti-corruption policies and practices as stipulated in the United Nations Convention Against Corruption Article 5.
The declaration also aligns with UNCSC Article 7, 8, 10 and encompasses elements of a number of other articles of the convention relating to transparency and engagement with the private sector.
Other integrity development instruments allowing self-assessment, action planning, implementation, and evaluation have been created over the years, such as the Integrity
Development Guide, which was conceived as a comprehensive integrity instrument set in response to the recommendation made at the Third Global Forum on Fighting Corruption and Safeguarding Integrity in June 2005. The WCO produced the first version of the WCO Compendium of Integrity Best Practices in collaboration with its member administrations. It was later enhanced with the WCO Compilation of Integrity Practices. The WCO recently published a compilation of integrity practices on internal control and relationship with external controls, focused on the four key areas of governance of internal controls, operational aspects, relationship with external controls, and sharing good practices amongst WCO members.